Open your eyes. Wake up, Link.
Oh, Jesus, John, I think I'm going to die. I'm going to die. This is too many podcasts. It's too many podcasts, man.
Every year we say the same.
It's too many podcasts. I don't know why. It's just that there's like three people who are like, I love you, three podcasts, do more. I'm like, validation from the internet. I will do whatever you want.
Well, it's also, let's also, preface this by going, last week we were like, oh yeah, next week's E3. Oh yeah, so it's going to be a heavy podcast week. Yeah, yep. We got to prepare for that. And like, but yeah, we could totally do it. We can knock them out in like a couple of days. It's not a big deal.
Yeah.
And then we end up spending the entire week like, oh, fucking God shit.
Yep. Oh, fucking God shit is right. Welcome to the end of the E3 coverage. Today we are going to be talking about Nintendo for a little while, and then we're going to be talking about various other trailers that didn't make it into the conferences but looked pretty cool anyway.
And we're talked about at E3.
Yes. Did we even introduce ourselves last time? I'm Jeff.
I'm John.
John, I have a quick question before we get started on this.
Okay.
I've been sick. I've been homebound. I haven't had a car. It's been weeks since I've seen anybody in the outside world, and I haven't been shaving my head recently. Do you think I should go back? Should you go cue ball, or should I let it grow? Let it grow. No, sorry, not that.
Probably shave it.
Shave it.
Yeah, you probably think so? Shave it. Yeah, probably shave it.
I got a lot of sun on my head. Anyway, all right. So let's talk about Nintendo.
Nintendo showed a lot of Legend of Zelda.
Boy, they were interesting this year. So Nintendo didn't have a Nintendo Direct, which I feel was a little weird.
I mean,
those things don't seem like they take a shitload of production to make. And I feel like before E3, they were like, we're just going to show Zelda. And then they ended up showing like eight things.
Well, they said that the first party thing, they were like, we're going to show Zelda. That's the only main first party game that we're going to show.
Yeah.
And then they were like, well, we're going to show Zelda and the new Pokemon games. Well, we're going to show Zelda, the new Pokemon games, and then some third party stuff.
Yeah. So, all right. I feel like the bulk of this particular one is going to be Zelda.
Yeah.
They started out with a nice trailer. Do you remember what the actual subtitle name of this is?
Breath of Fire?
Breath of Wind?
Breath of Life? Breath of Life?
Wind of Fate? Life of Zelda? Here, we'll go to the end and I can tell you. Come on. Breath of the Wild.
Yeah, the one thing that I couldn't. Yeah,
it's John late, and I folks. Have been doing this for a long.
We
time
have been recording
today.
For a long period today and yesterday and it, 2 days before that.
Before that, yeah. The trailer for this is was really lovely. I feel like it's a lot of kind of what we've seen so far in Zelda. If I was just to look at this trailer, I'd be like, this looks a little bit different. But it's still Link. He's riding a horse. There's a world. It's full of trees and shit like that.
Climbing up trees, climbing up buildings, climbing up rocks.
Yeah. I mean, more climbing than I'm used to. But then Nintendo spent like, 4 or 5 hours just showing this game?
It was like literally the first day they were like, well, we're going to talk a little bit about Pokemon for about 30 minutes.
Yeah, we'll come back to that later.
And then they were like, and then the rest of the first day is just going to be nothing but Zelda.
Nothing but this kind of like this one area in the beginning part of Zelda.
And they showed about 4 or 5, maybe 6 hours of Zelda.
They showed a lot of Zelda.
And then at the very end of it, they were like, by the way, we only showed you like less than 1% of the game.
Okay, so let's start at the beginning. It looks like Link like wakes up out of this like cryogenic like sleep almost.
Yeah, like this weird like deprivation chamber cryopod thing. And like everything has a very sci-fi technological feel to it almost.
I am going to spend a lot of time saying how much this is like the best thing I've seen on Nintendo in a long time, because he wakes up and he gets like this iPad and then he opens up the world and it's like this is a world that has seen like it seems like some kind of cataclysm.
This world has seen some shit, yo.
And it's been a long time. There's ruins everywhere. It's mostly wild. Like at least in the area that we're seeing that they showed at E3. And I quite frankly, I love it.
Yeah. No, it looks great.
I just love the idea of Hyrule in ruins And you know that you were asleep, and then the cataclysm happened while you were asleep.
Well, what's interesting, if you actually look at the logo, look at the Master Sword that's in the logo.
It's like rusty.
It's like rusted and like cracked and like all fucked up.
Yeah,
like it kind of tells you that something happened.
Yeah, like as opposed to most of the other Zeldas that we've played recently. I mean, the last new one was Skyward Sword, right?
Yeah,
but you know, these are like, oh, there's a temple, and oh, here's a village, and oh, here's civilization. I ain't seeing shit. Like, you walk out of this cave, essentially, and you run into, like, this old guy by a fire, and then it's kind of just like, well, do whatever, I suppose, and you go out into the world.
And they even said, like, they were talking about it, and they even said that the kind of interesting thing about the game is that they don't really, outside of the beginning of the game, is essentially you wake up to a voice saying, wake up. Wake up. And then, you wake up, you leave the cave you're in, and that's all the story you get.
Right.
Like, and they basically said that it's one of those things where you have to go find the story. They're not going to hold hand you. There's not going to be like moments where you like, oh, you've collected X amount of these things. Here's a story trigger, you know, or here's this kind of trigger. It's, you have to go find out what the story is on your own.
So you're saying
at your own
that
pace.
The story is hidden in environmental details of a world that's crumbling in ruins, and your protagonist awakens after a long period and has to go out in the world.
You know what?
And manage their stamina and their weapon durability.
I'm going to give you a pass on this because in the actual stream, I was the one who first said it and went, they really added a lot of Dark Souls to this game.
Hey-o! Dark Souls. Everything is Dark Souls. I'm going to, you know, I almost feel like I haven't sold a t-shirt off of Rage Select in a long time. I just feel like making a t-shirt that just has big block letters that says
everything is
Dark Souls. And then I'm going to buy one and I'm going to wear it myself. And I'm never going to sell it to the general public. I don't know.
You should make at least, make some for your co-website people, co-hosts.
Yeah. You know, chime in the comments. Do you want a t-shirt that says everything is Dark Souls? The city of Austin's already tried to get sales tax out of me, even though I didn't sell anything last year. So anyway, this is a really interesting, really interesting game world. Like, here's some of the things that I could tell you that are really fascinating. One, you can climb wherever the fuck you want to.
Yeah, there's it basically, you can climb any surface. It's just, the biggest thing is that can your stamina allow you to climb up what you're trying to climb? Because if your stamina runs out while you're climbing, you're gonna lose your grip and fall off.
Yep.
And if you're too high up, you die.
Yep. As far as other environmental things, we can see right here on the screen, we're watching one of the two 30-minute demos that's over on the Nintendo channel. There is also a little sound meter for stealth.
Yeah.
There's actually a huge amount of like kind of open world. I would actually say like Far Cry style stealth. I mean, hell, even like when we're talking about Ubisoft conference, you can use your little tablet to look at enemies from afar and then mark them.
Yeah.
So you can see them through the environment and plan stealth attacks. There's like so many different ways that you can dick with this world. And then in addition to that, there's also a temperature gauge.
Yeah.
Which at first I thought was weird until I saw that like there's tundra and there's warm places, and you're going to have to actually change your outfit up based on the environment that you're in. Like if you go to a cold place and you don't have warm clothes, I saw a little thing where he's like freezing. And
yeah, you have to account for that. And like, I also like the fact that, you know, there are outfits that you get throughout the game, and you don't have to be wearing the standard Legend of Zelda tunic the entire time.
Yeah. In the original trailer, we saw like a heavier armor that he was wearing. So there's that, but then I think what's most interesting about this is this entire world just feels really alive because like, so, okay, I tell you what, let's
well, one other change that they made that I think we should probably mention is the heart system.
Mm-hmm.
You don't, like previously in previous games, you would just like, you would break open pots or you'd kill an enemy or you'd cut grass and it would like a heart would pop up and you collect the heart and hey, your heart meter fills up.
Right.
The heart meter's still there, but there are no more hearts anymore.
Oh, yeah.
Now it's, you actually have to eat food.
Right.
Certain foods will give you, will fill your heart meter. Some foods may even give you temporary extra hearts.
Yeah. Oh, there's a whole crafting mechanic of like picking up like mushrooms and meat and various different things. And
yeah, you can cut down trees. Mm-hmm. There's fire, you can light everything in the world on fire.
Yep. Very Far Cry. Far Cry that way is that, you know, we saw a thing where there was a campfire and you could set like your torch on, or you know, like a torch or a wooden weapon or something like that on fire, and then light the grass in order to smoke out enemies or whatever. I actually saw a thing that was really interesting where we'll come back to this a little bit over and over again, an emergent gameplay thing where the guy that was playing the demo lit a torch on fire in on a campfire, and then he saw, what do they call them, bokoblins?
Yeah.
Threw that flaming torch at two bokoblins, or tried to throw it near them to catch
moblins, but
no, they're not that. They have a different name here. Moblins are bigger and different.
Oh, okay.
Threw the torch near them to try to set the grass that they were near on fire. It missed, and then one of those bokoblins walked over to his torch and set his torch on fire using the fire that was there, and then started coming at Link with a fiery club. Like, the whole thing, like, backfired. And I was just like, wow, that's amazing. That's an amazing little set of events that happened. So one of the other things that they showed that I think is really, really interesting is the fact that your weapons break.
Yeah, your weapons break. Even going back to what you were talking about, how the McCoblin or whatever went over and used the torch, there are moments where you'll come up on a camp and like they won't be like just standing around with their weapons walking around. They'll be sitting around a campfire. Their weapons will be on the ground next to them. And then when they see you, they'll actually look around, see you, grab their weapon from off the ground, and then come at you.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it feels very like a lived-in world, like you said.
Yeah, it feels, because that's one of the things about Zelda, is that Zelda's great, but it always feels very scripted to me. You know, you go to this area, there's these enemies, they do this thing. Whereas this, it's just like, you know, you can, you know, oh, I'm out of wood, I'm going to chop down this tree, and then I'm going to get some wood, or, you know, I'm going to need to forage and get buffs. There was even a part here where the guy that was doing the stage show ran across a boss, and he was like, oh, usually when I fight this boss, I go make a potion that gives me more speed so that I can get behind it faster, so I can get, you know, like, there's so much going on here, and it's such a departure from the very strict, and I feel like not even just Zelda, but that all of Nintendo has this very strict, very well-crafted level design philosophy, right?
Yeah.
Where you're, you know, it's a Mario level, right? Where you're going from A to B, and there's these obstacles in between. Same with Zelda. And here, it's like, goddamn, I've seen several hours of videos where you're just tootling around the world doing whatevskis, you know.
Well, it's like, I think I talked to you about it, and you had said it, that you had, or at least said it, that you had talked to someone who had the comment, is that it really feels like that prior to this, they were really trying to recreate Ocarina of Time.
Oh, yeah, it was almost Matt Frank, like every and time. And I were talking about that, yeah.
And it feels like this is the first time that they've gone, okay, let's do something, let's break the mold. And the game's director, I always forget his name, but the person who's directing this game even came out and said, yeah, I wanted to do stuff that has never been done in a Zelda game, which is why there's technology,
right?
Why there is actual, like, this almost kind of a sci-fi bent to some things.
It feels like a world that had high magic / technology that is now in disrepair. So that is actually a great lead into the fact that there are these shrines that have these runes that you can download into your iPad that you have that will give you powers. That's how you get bombs. That's how you get that. So far, the only two that I've seen are bombs and then this Magneto beam. And the bombs are actually really cool because they come in two varieties.
Yeah.
They're round bombs and they're square bombs. So if you want to roll a bomb into a McCoblin camp and then blow it up, you could do that. In fact, we saw a thing here in this gameplay demo that we're watching where one of the enemies was chasing the player and they threw a bomb and then kind of like ran in front of it and then detonated it when the chasing enemy was over it. I just love how much it feels like there's a million different ways to do everything that you're seeing.
Yeah.
It's a sense of freedom that I feel like hasn't been in a Zelda game for a long time. And that is something that really just makes this feel like, I mean, it sounds like hyperbole, and who knows when it's going to come out, when it comes out, if this is going to follow, but it feels like the most interesting Zelda game I've seen since fucking I went to 3D Zelda from 2D Zelda.
Yeah.
Which for me was actually Wind Waker, because I didn't play any of the N64 games. But, you know, this feels like a departure from that from what they've done previously.
Yeah,
hell,
no,
just
it does.
The stamina meter. Just having a stamina meter is a huge change.
Yeah. No, it was actually like watching the opening of the game, watching the beginning of the game, I got to a point where I felt like, okay, I don't want to watch any more of this because I want to play the game.
Yeah.
And I actually stopped watching because I was like, I don't want to know anymore. I want to discover it all for myself because they're essentially just playing the game.
Yeah. Yeah. It's pretty amazing. They also have, I mean, you know, I love this idea that like one of the things that they have is that you can hold multiple things in your hands.
Yeah.
So like when you're cooking, you can put multiple things in your hands. But like here we just saw Link had a bundle of sticks and then a piece of flint and then dropped them both on the ground and then struck the flint and the whole thing turned into a fire. I love that Minecraft aspect to it of being able to make, kind of make other things. There's also a whole bunch of different ways to solve certain puzzles. Like I saw one gameplay video where the other shrine thing that they're talking about, the Magneto Beam, that basically lets you pick up certain things and then move them around in the world. And they're really using it. Feels, I said this to you before, it feels an awful lot like Half-Life 2's physics puzzles.
Yeah.
Where they've got this physics system that actually works really well, and they're just, you know, just playing with it to see what to give you the opportunity to solve things the way that you want to, which is absolutely incredible in comparison to previous Zelda games. So yeah, it seems like there are these shrines that you go into that have these little kind of like sub areas where you can you get these new powers, and then you get these new runes that you can then use to make bombs or make magneto beams or make whatever. One of the things that we've seen is like way off in the distance there appears to be some kind of like cataclysm happening. And in the trailer, it's funny because the trailer that we saw had this particular biome and not a lot else, but they did have one where it was like a giant wasteland with like big skeleton bones on it. As far as enemies go, outside of the macoblins that we've seen, there are chew jellies that you can, like little slimes that you can kill. We've also seen a couple of bosses. One was basically that thing from the trailer last year. That was like the giant kind of like cyber Octorok thing.
Oh, yeah. Which apparently, like, there's a lot of those.
Yeah. Which, and they seem like, at least for the gameplay demos that I've seen being played, they seem pretty deadly, right?
Yeah, and they're also like most of them that you run into are like half buried into the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it's interesting.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I kind of want to be the first person to come to this opening area and chop down every single tree. I want to deforest this area and see what happens. But I've also seen some stuff where like they've got a whole system of bringing up the map for the area, and you could set down markers about like, oh, this is a good place for this thing. Or,
now,
I didn't know
that he could do this. I didn't see this before. So what he was doing is he was taking out a sword, and this creature was running away from him and was too fast. So he would take a sword, and he actually was throwing his sword at the thing.
Yeah.
It never hit, but...
I've seen that happen a few times with the clubs as well, because like when you're fighting enemies, they'll drop their weapons sometimes, and shields wear out too. Bows wear out. I saw somebody playing and they broke their bow. They had to go find another bow, which actually is really interesting because it makes me wonder whether like at the end of the day, one of the advantages to the Master Sword is going to be that you finally have a weapon that doesn't break that you can use forever. But yeah, this whole world feels really interesting. There's like secrets all over the place. I saw one video where a guy found some treasure chests that had fire arrows and ice arrows that he could use to like freeze enemies or set places on fire. There's ruins. I'm curious to know if they only showed less than 1% how goddamn big this world is.
Yeah.
Like you're going to need a horse, which actually I think you can actually... We saw some horses in the trailer where you could just jump up and ride a horse.
He tamed a horse at one
okay.
point.
Yeah, it looks like one of the best. It's one of the most exciting things that I've seen this E3.
Yeah. A lot of people liked what was shown of Zelda and the Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild, and liked a lot the fact that they showed so much of it.
Yeah.
So much that I've actually seen some people be like, look, if you want to talk about press conferences, yes, Sony won the press conferences. But if you want to talk about E3, Nintendo won it with just Zelda.
I'm not going to sit here and tell you that it wasn't.
I don't necessarily agree with that, but I'm saying I've heard people say it, and not people who are like diehard Nintendo fanboys.
Well, this is a brief aside. A brief aside that we can go on is that the press conference coverage was good.
Yeah,
the lead up to E3, getting all those weird leak trailers was good. The IGN and GameSpot and Sony and all their coverage like after the conferences this year,
yeah,
has been a little bland.
Yeah, it was
like it's just not doing a whole crap load for me. So it's good that Nintendo did this because like it was also interesting that they did this and that they just kept doing it. Like,
yeah,
I don't think I've ever seen an E3 where you had somebody that focused this much on one game.
Yeah,
which is good because I feel like it got everybody real super freaking excited. And I personally can't wait to see. Oh, you know, here's another thing. There was a great moment that I saw where like Link was doing a thing and there was like darkness over him, and when he looked up, it's because there's clouds that move.
Yeah,
in the sky.
Yeah, there is a day. There is a day-night cycle in the game
that will blot stuff out, which actually has a lot of interesting ramifications.
Yeah,
or could have a lot of interesting ramifications on gameplay.
Yeah, no, they said there is a day-night cycle, and there will be a I think you will have to sleep mm-hmm. at some point as well. I don't know if that's true. That's I'm thinking that's the case, but I haven't heard it.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, I like I said, everything I'm hearing, it's like they're trying a bunch of new stuff with this game and in a way that it seems to work.
Well, it's just great because again, Nintendo is such a conservative game company that I feel like they don't like to take risks, and this feels risky. And
yeah,
it feels nice to see Nintendo be a little bit risky about what they're doing with their games. So that is Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild. I don't know that I have a whole hell of a lot more to say outside of the fact that I really want to play this.
Yeah, ditto.
I'm kind of, it does make me curious though with the amount of, this is just kind of a weird aside for Nintendo, but the amount of Wii U pad integration that we've seen here, with using it like a pad, like it's actually mirrored in the game with your yeah. little tablet, makes me wonder if the NX is definitely going to have some kind of tablet component to it.
It might.
If it's coming out on the NX as well. But then I guess, they put out Twilight Princess on the Wii with motion controls, and then it was just straight up controller on the GameCube. So yeah, I'm sorry, I could sit here and watch this all goddamn day long. All right, well, let's move on to something else. So we've got a few like smaller Nintendo announcements that I don't know that I have a shitload to talk about with.
Yeah.
One is Pokemon Sun and Moon. They were kind of mean, or I feel like they were a little bit mean when they had a 5-minute trailer for Zelda, and then on their live stream they immediately went to like 40 minutes of Pokemon Sun and Moon, and I was just like, oh man, come on, guys. Like, I mean, I know Pokemon's a thing and people like Pokemon, but it just, like, I don't know. So I'm going to say right now that we're not going to talk at all about Pokemon Sun and Moon because John and I are fans.
Well, it's not that I'm not a fan. It's just I don't really, I've played the Pokemon games. I own Pokemon X. My girlfriend owns Pokemon Y. But it's like I don't really play them all that much.
Yeah.
So.
Also, they did a big Pokemon Go roundtable thing.
Yeah.
I tried to skip through it. I wasn't going to watch a whole 40 minutes of Pokemon Go. I'm sorry. There may be some interesting stuff in there for people that are interested in that particular game. I kept waiting for them to fight stuff, and they never fought anything, which is a little like, eh. Let's see. Ever Oasis? I don't think that we knew about Ever Oasis. Oh, hey, look, in the nighttime of Zelda, there's bats and skeletons.
Yep.
Sorry. We still got that video up here. I actually need to get past this particular video. So Ever Oasis is a 3DS game that's coming out. It's actually being made. The director is the guy who made Final Fantasy 1, 2, and 3.
Yes.
I can tell you a little bit about it. Again, this wasn't a thing. Everything else except for Paper Mario and Tokyo Sessions was 3DS games.
Yeah.
So this is being made by Grezzo, who are the guys who did the localization of Majora's Mask and Ocarina of Time and a few other things. And it's being directed by the guy who did Final Fantasy 1, 2, and 3. And it appears that it's like your character comes to this desert and creates an oasis, and that you end up making shops that attract like adventurers, and then taking those adventurers out to get better stuff, to get better shops, and that like your party lineup, like everybody that you have in your party is going to have very different ability sets.
Yeah.
So there might be some dungeons where you're going to require a person that can do this or do that or do whatever. It looks fine. It looks like a little, I mean, it's one of those games that it looks, it doesn't look offensive or anything. It just looks like one of those games that I'm not going to be super, super interested in buying on day one. So there's that. There's also Mario Party on the 3DS, which again, do you have any strong feelings about Mario Party, John?
No, not really.
It looks like what you can get Mario characters to be your sidekicks. Everybody moves at the same time. There's mini games. It's Mario Party.
Yeah, apparently you play as a Toad.
Yeah,
and then you can get actual Mario characters as sidekicks to help you play.
Yep. You are going to get fucked out of your stars, as always.
Yeah, of course. It wouldn't be Mario Party without it.
But outside of that, I don't really know that I have a whole hell of a lot to say about that. Yo-Kai Watch 2.
Yeah.
Is another game that I don't have very much to say. I don't have a lot to say about a lot of this.
It's like the next Pokemon in Japan, apparently.
Well,
like it's, and by that, I mean it's like that popular. Like it's Yo-Kai Watch. You go around collecting ghosts.
Yep. I mean, I like what I'm seeing. I like the fact what they're splitting this one into Yo-Kai Watch 2 Bony Spirits and Yo-Kai Watch 2 Fleshy Souls, which I guess are the, what, Diamond and Ruby Sun and Moon of Yo-Kai. I like they have a part in this trailer where they show some of the little spirits that you pick up. I like the one that's like a twisty-headed lady that looks an awful lot like something out of Fatal Frame. Apparently, there's also going to be a part where you go back in time and you discover where the Yo-Kai Watch came from originally.
Oh.
So, yeah, if you're a fan of Yo-Kai Watch, I mean, it looks cool. I kind of like the idea that it reminds me a little bit of Persona and how bizarre it is.
Yeah.
But I just don't know that I have time for a game where you're going to spend a million years collecting Yo-Kais and training them and then blast on other stuff.
I get it.
Monster Hunter Generations is coming. I'm not sure the relationship of this to the previous Monster Hunters. The trailer looks an awful lot like Monster Hunter. Again, this is one of those areas where I'm sorry that I don't know more.
I mean, the trailer did say that not all monsters were hunted, that some of them survived and they evolved.
Okay.
And so these are
this is like the future. This is a new breed of monster for a new breed of Monster Hunter.
Yeah, they changed and evolved, you know. So
it's do you have any feelings about the Monster Hunter franchise, John?
I've honestly never played any of them.
I tried to get into it.
I think I tried to play Monster Hunter 3.
Yeah.
And like whatever the first Wii U one, I think it was Monster Hunter 3.
There's a lot of like
I just couldn't do it.
There's a lot of apparently like DNA similarity between this and the Souls games about like figuring stuff out and kind of being hard and obtuse and stuff, but
yeah.
I just can't. It doesn't really do that series. I've tried it a few times, and when I kind of learn like, "Oh, this is what it's going to be about," I'm kind of like, "Eh, I don't know. I don't really know that that's really what Jeff is down with." Let's see. Next up, we have the Dragon Quest VII trailer.
Yeah,
which
looks like Dragon Quest.
Looks an awful lot like a Dragon Quest game. Yeah, it's got a class system. I did notice that there was one class in here that looked really interesting. That was the shepherd. Who is dressed up like a sheep.
Yeah. it's like, all right, well, you know.
Yeah. This one's going to have time travel as well. But, you know, last year didn't Square, I mean, I think I said this before, right? But last year didn't Square show this. And did they also show there was going to be a console version of this that was all super fancy graphics and looked really good?
I don't remember.
I thought they did. It might have been at a separate concert conference that they.
I mean, I thought I remember that there was going to be a Dragon Quest console game, like regular. You know, I don't know if it was going to be this game ported to consoles, but I do remember there was supposed to be something.
Okay. Yeah, I haven't been keeping up with my Dragon Quest games. What was the last Dragon Warrior game you played?
Oh, fuck, I don't know.
I think it was 1 for me. I think after I beat Dragon Warrior 1, then I was just like, okay. In fact, I bought that thing on my phone, and the port for it is fucking terrible. Okay, so I you know, I feel kind of bad here that we don't have a whole shitload to talk about in, with some of these games. I'm going to go ahead and briefly talk about Rhythm Heaven Megamix, which has things from a bunch of the different Rhythm Heaven games. It's a Rhythm Heaven game.
Yeah, if you've played a Rhythm Heaven game, you know exactly what to expect with us, because it's that.
Yeah. This is kind of why I love this new Zelda so much, is because I have stuff to say about it, as opposed to like, well, it's a new Mario game, a new Rhythm Heaven game, it's a new Mario Party, you know, that's pretty much the same as the last one with minor. It's a new Animal Crossing game. Is exactly the thing that I don't really care for when it comes to Nintendo. But I'll tell you what I do care for.
You care about this a lot.
I care an awful lot about, it could be out this week or next week, or when, depends on when this podcast comes out, Tokyo Mirage Sessions, hashtag FE. So there's a trailer for this that is appropriately berserk bananas, nutso craziness, where a bunch of people are just screaming stuff and yelling stuff, and I don't know what any of it's about.
I don't know.
What do you think you're doing? We're in the middle of a battlefield. Look at all these enemies. We're in a stadium. I'm a wizard. Blah, 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 blah. But they actually did have a real nice little, like 30-minute stage demo for Tokyo Mirage sessions. Hashtag FE, which was really cool. Showed some of the new, right, I guess it was like kind of a boss battle that had a lot of like conditional to it, where you couldn't even really hurt the boss without
meeting certain conditions.
Yeah, without seducing them first, which was amazing, because there were two lady characters in the group, and the seduce animation was just this weird like, oh, look how cute I'm being. Let's see if I can find it here. I just passed it. It was pretty amazing. I am glad that this game is coming out at the end of the week. I kind of wish that... Is this Namco Bandai that's doing Tokyo Mirage?
Is it? I thought it was Atlas.
Oh, it is Atlas. I'm sorry. Yeah, derp. I kind of wish that Atlas would put this out on more consoles.
Well, this is a partnership with Nintendo.
Oh, like Nintendo
because
paid
of
for
Fire
it.
Emblem.
Oh, boo. This was
they could only put it on a Nintendo console. So,
well, I'm trying to think of the last time that there was a really big kind of like turn-based Berserko Japanese RPG that came out on, I mean, not like one of these NIS like small little side project things that they just happened to localize, but like a big fuck off Persona, Final Fantasy, Dragon Quest, you know, RPG on the consoles. And I'm having a hard time coming up with anything. You think of anything?
Outside of the upcoming Persona 5, yeah. No, same here.
I mean, something that's come out for those current generation. I mean, you know, there's plenty of RPG Maker stuff on Steam. I mean, there's like Tales of Zestiria or whatever came out on the consoles. But yeah, this looks crazy. In fact, after they get done with this particular fight, they actually said something when they were talking about playing the game, where they say that the battles and everything are so dynamic that even grinding doesn't feel like grinding, and I'm like, hell yeah, that sounds great, because I haven't been a smitten kitten for a JRPG in a long time.
Yeah, and apparently after some of the battles, you get like a J-pop dance number.
Oh no, I think that was from the from this like weird power up shrine that I don't know what it is, where a person and their it's not a persona, like the a person and whatever they're like. They're whatever it is, like bond, and there's this like crazy thing, and then there's like a whole like anime J-pop number. I remember last year them talking about how they actually went out and got like top tier actual J-pop producers to write.
Well, like apparently everyone's J-pop. Apparently everyone's saying that the music is really fucking catchy and the videos are really really amazing, and they you know, they're really great.
They're dancing on a stage underneath an upside down cake, John.
Yeah.
It's look at the way that these ladies are dressed and tell me that Japan doesn't have all the best crazy. Like, if you want to see something, if you want to know, by God, that the game you're going to play is not going to be a boring military shooter that's just stock standard, go find yourself something that Atlus has published. Somebody in the comments is going to point out that Atlus has like a whole series of like boring military games that I don't know about.
I don't think they do. I think they mostly focus on localization of foreign games.
Yeah,
of Japanese games.
So yeah, this looks nutty. I love it. And it comes out at the end of next week. I cannot wait to play it. It looks all kinds of crazy. It might even get me into the Shin Megami Tensei series.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of want to play it myself. Yeah. So.
You know what? Outside of all the rest of this, just FYI, because I didn't even know this, it turns out that Nintendo announced that they're putting out Severed, the Drinkbox Studio Vita game on the 3DS and the Wii U. And it's coming like at the end of this month.
Yeah.
Which is great, because I want to play Severed, but I don't want to buy it for a system that I don't ever touch. So that is good.
So what system are you going to buy it for if you want to buy it for a system you don't ever touch?
My 3DS, I guess? Yeah, good point there, John. I was thinking Wii U so we could have it on the show. I'll have my Wii U all out and dust it off for
Tokyo Mirage Sessions Sharp FE.
Yep. What a dumb fucking name. Fuck you.
Yeah. It's not a hashtag, Jeff. It's a sharp.
It's a musical note. I'll say pound sign if I want to. I don't care. Not even pound signs there anymore.
Well, I'll pound you in the face.
So last up on the Nintendo Parade, we had Paper Mario. What was this one? Paper Mario Color Splash? Color Splash.
Yeah.
Which I feel like is going to be like one of the last Mario games on the Wii U, because NX is coming next year. Anything else they're doing from now on is probably going to be NX. I like the look of this. I think it's really interesting.
Awkward voice acting.
Is this voice acting? Do we even know that this is part of the game, or if this was just some kind of demo thing?
I don't know.
It's just a really weird narrator going like, and then Mario opened up a present. And that present contained this. And so seeing them on this ship that's in the roiling ocean, all I can think of is the beginning of Battle Block Theater.
It's like Poseidon himself held out his hand in friendship and you spat in his mouth.
Oh, man, I love that fucking intro. Anyway, so, you know, Mario and friends have come to this island that's having, like, all the color drained out of it. And so you've got to, like, throw the color back in. You guys pretty much can probably guess where this is going. You know, there's stamps. There's different paint buckets that'll follow you around. There's, like, the whole RPG system is set up with cards that you throw out. The game, one of the things I like about this is that this game seems like it's a perfect Wii U game in that it's using the environmental textures very well. Everything looks like very realistic, like paper and stuff. I've never actually played any of the Paper Mario games.
Oh, the Paper Mario games are great.
Yeah?
Yeah, I love them.
When is this? Do we know when this is coming out?
I think they announced at the end of this video.
Let me see. Let me just type it in.
That we're watching. I think this is when they announced the release date for it.
Okay.
I think
October 7th. Man,
there you go.
Fuck you, game industry. Why does everything have to come out in October, November, and December? Can't we get anything in September? How about July? July is dick this year. I want more in July. I don't want to have to go back and play old dumb games that I don't want to play.
All right.
So yeah, this looks good. I'll play it. I got a Wii U. Might as well get as many uses out of it as I can before I put it in a box and never touch it
again. Until the NX comes out and you never touch the Wii U ever again.
Yep. I let Brian Salisbury take my copy of Splatoon.
Oh, nice.
I think he gave it away to somebody.
Oh.
I'm all right with that. I wasn't using it for anything anyway. That game was fun, but just didn't, you know. I think it's a thing that we don't talk about that often, that the Wii U has some really fun games, but I don't keep my Wii U hooked up all the time. So there's also the thing of like, I don't want to go all the way over there. It's also got two things I got to plug in. I got to plug in the console. And invariably, the pad is always completely out of battery. I got to go find the bullshit for that. Got to stretch it to a place on the couch. My life is hard, John.
I know.
That's what I'm trying to tell you. It's a hard, difficult life. Well, how do we feel that this whole thing went out for Nintendo before we take a break?
You know, I think that, you know, given the fact that, you know, they're not really announcing anything that we, you know, big.
Yeah.
You know, it's a little disappointing in that regard, but we already accepted that disappointment before the E3 even happened.
Haven't you accepted that disappointment a long time if you're a Nintendo fan?
Oh.
They don't announce very often. It's always like, oh, look, it's that new Minis game that is an amiibo.
Well,
game.
I know a lot of people were hoping that they would talk about the NX, that they would break their promise to not talk about it.
Yeah, I was about to say, did they put out like a press statement that said
yes. A lot, they put out a press release that said we're not going to be talking about NX because that's not coming out until 2017, until March of 2017 or whatever. And everyone went, well, shouldn't you talk about it if it's coming out in March?
Yeah, there's not going to be an E3 between now and next March.
Yeah, and then they were just like, nope, we're not going to talk about it, so we're only talking about Zelda and then a few other games.
I don't understand the thinking at Nintendo. I really don't. I still don't understand, just like Project Scorpio announcing that there's going to be a new console in like 9 months. I mean, whatever happened to just like keeping that shit under wraps until like 48 hours before it was time to go?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I liked what I saw fair enough. I mean, I feel like they spent a lot of time on Pokemon and Yo-Kai Watch and 3DS games. I mean, I guess...
They had to span out 3 days.
I guess they've kind of given up on the Wii U, right? Like, yeah. Is there anything else besides what we've seen? And those things were announced, like, Tokyo Mirage Sessions. I was watching that last year on the stream.
Yeah, I mean, same with this game. This was announced during the, like, one or two... Nintendo Directs ago?
Yeah. Like, yeah. I guess there's still that Sonic and Mario at the Rio Olympics or whatever.
Oh, yeah,
but
there's that, but...
Yeah, I don't know. Kind of seems like it. Kind of seems like they're putting all their eggs back into the NX basket. I actually really am excited to see how how Zelda looks on the NX.
Because, yeah, it looks... From what we've seen, it looks great on the Wii U.
Yeah. So it would be nice to see if it looks like dramatically better on the NX. I will probably buy a console just to play that one game.
Yeah, no, I already know that we're going to be getting an NX when it comes out. And since the Zelda game is reportedly coming out at the same time for both NX and Wii U, I would also assume that's probably around the same time that the NX is coming out.
Yeah. Oh, do we not have a firm launch date on Zelda yet?
I don't think so, no.
Okay.
But I think they also said March.
March?
Yeah, just March.
Okay.
So it's one of those things where, you know what, if I'm going to be buying on the NX, you know, if I'm going to be buying an NX, because me and my girlfriend have already decided that it's going to happen because we love Nintendo.
Sure.
You know, might as well just buy that as the game, our first game for it.
Yeah. You know? Well, actually it would be, I mean, you know, I guess it would.
I mean, I did that with the Nintendo Wii. I bought Twilight Princess as part of it.
That wasn't out then.
Yeah, that was a launch title.
Oh, Wii. I thought you said Wii U.
No, Wii.
Okay. It would be kind of a coup for them, though, to be able to launch the NX and have the new Zelda game sitting there right along with it. I feel like that would drive a lot of system sales.
Well, I feel like that's what part of what got the hardcore fans to buy the Nintendo Wii.
Yeah.
You know, obviously not the Wii U. I'm talking about the previous one. But because I know I bought that in, like, two other games. I can't remember what they were.
But that was a game that had already been out for a while when the Wii released, right?
No, it launched on GameCube at the same time.
Twilight Princess?
Yeah.
Huh.
Or it came out a little bit after.
That's odd, because I remember buying... I guess I got my whole... Okay. Yeah, both same day.
Yeah,
Yeah, December of 2006. Crazy. Crazy. I thought that I had my GameCube. I didn't think the Wii was even out at that point.
Yeah, no, I know, because I camped out at a Best Buy in Minnesota to get that.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay. That sounds terrible.
It was.
It sounds
was
like
cold.
A terrible experience.
Yeah.
And then you got home and you had a Wii.
Well, no, I got back to my hotel room and had a Wii and plugged it up to the hotel TV and played Twilight Princess and
Wii Sports.
Wii Sports and Red Steel.
Oh, I forgot about Red Steel so much. All right, folks. Well, I tell you what. We're going to go ahead and we're going to take a break. When we come back, we've got one more push left to go.
Almost done.
Before we birth this E3 2016 baby, we're going to talk about miscellaneous trailers and stuff. This one may be a little bit shorter than the other ones because, you know, I don't feel like either one of us have a huge amount to say about this Nintendo stuff. So
yeah,
stick around. We will be right back. All right, here we go. Final stretch. You got to reach deep within, reach deep down inside. You got to find that thing that keeps you going when nothing else can do. It's called cocaine, and I've had to break out the emergency supply. Actually, that's just called Starbucks coffee.
Yeah,
for me,
yeah, so, it's just caffeine.
It's beef jerky and Dr. Pepper for John. But,
yeah, yeah.
So, hey, everybody, we're down to our last little bit of E3 2016.
Yeah.
And we are going with miscellaneous trailers.
Yeah, just miscellaneous trailers, gameplay walkthroughs and stuff like that.
Yeah, we didn't have a whole shitload of them to look at. I'm actually really kind of disappointed. I think that maybe... the next time you and I are on the podcast, I can go back and watch one of those like stage demos for Agents of Mayhem.
Yeah.
Did you watch any of those?
Yeah, no, I did.
Can you talk about
it? Yes, I can definitely talk about it.
Talk about it.
So it is a single player game.
Okay.
So you don't get to create your own character this time.
Boo! Loretta, boo!
Yeah, they basically said that the style of game that they wanted to make this time around did not allow for... player created character types.
Uh-huh.
Because the idea is that you have you're an agency that is basically been set up to battle this forces of Legion, which is this evil organization.
Tell me that's an acronym.
That's an acronym.
Excellent.
I don't know what it's an acronym for, but it is an acronym.
Okay, all right.
But it's this basically it's this organization, evil organization designed on world domination, obviously.
Wait, an evil organization determined to rule the world?
Yes.
Like fucking Cobra?
Kind of, yeah. Oh. And they actually did state that one of the big inspirations for this game is G.I. Joe.
Nice.
They're totally like that. That is kind of one of the things that they like about it.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, as the leader of Mayhem, you get to go into the city, and you basically pick a three squad team. Three person squad.
Okay.
And I think they said there's somewhere between, like, I want to say either 16 or 23 characters or something like that. I can't remember the exact number.
Okay.
I just remember it is a double digit number, but it's like in either the teens or the 20s.
Now, is it an open world game?
It is an open world game.
So you're going to be like, are you going to be finding quests out in the world, or are you going to be spawning into the world?
No. You're going to be finding quests out into the world, and then you're also going to be discovering... villain lairs,
okay,
which are procedurally generated.
Oh, nice.
And the lairs are essentially you go in and it's basically like a if you want to go in the old RPG style, it's a dungeon.
Okay.
Because like the guy kind of referred to it as a dungeon a few times, and then when one of the interviews I watched,
yeah,
and then when the host called him on it, on it's like, oh, so they're dungeons, and he goes, well, I misspoke. We're supposed to be calling them
lairs.
Yeah, villainous lairs.
So it looks in looking at the, we're watching this gameplay kind of snippet here off of IGN. It looks like the characters we've seen. Ahab and their Johnny Cage guy.
There's Fortune and Glory, which is the girl. Glory is the girl in her. No. Yeah, or her name is Fortune, and the drone is named Glory.
Okay.
I can't remember which one it is. And then there's there's Hollywood, and then there's Ahab or whatever his fucking
name is. But it seems like Ahab and Hollywood were both using the same gun. Did they talk at all about, because like Fortune was using twin pistols, whereas the other two seem to be. Or maybe not. Maybe he's using a shotgun.
He was using a shotgun. And they're essentially kind of like Overwatch. There are different classes.
Okay.
And there's multiple characters in those classes.
Okay.
But the cool thing is, so you pick your three person team.
Okay.
And you're running around as one of those members of that team.
Yeah.
But you can switch between the three characters at will. Like, so you'll be like, you'll be running in causing damage. You'll do your special and then switch to another person and do their special and then do another, you know, switch to another character and do their, like, you're just doing this on the fly.
That's really cool. That's, do they have, I wasn't looking when they switched last time, but do they have separate health and energy bars?
I don't know.
Let's see if we could spot when he changes and see if it stays the same. I'm waiting for her. Yes.
Yes.
Let's say they do. So it's almost like, I wonder if it's like some of those tag team games where you can basically tag somebody in and then use them. And then, you know, if they start getting low, you can tag them out for somebody else. They all have their own. Okay, so they all have their own powers.
They all have their own powers. Like, even there, you know, there's different classes. They all have their own specialized personalities and powers as far as their characters go.
Okay.
And you can actually pick three characters from the same class, and they're saying that that's not going to have an effect on how you play the game.
Like, okay.
It's just the way they classify their characters, essentially. That they're saying they want you to pick the three characters that you like, essentially. They want you to find the three characters that you think work well together, but, you know, all of them work well together in different ways.
Okay.
So there's essentially, there may be a situation where I play as three specific people and you play as three other specific people.
Yeah.
And that's where kind of the G.I. Joe aspect came into play that they were referring to.
Uh-huh.
Is that this is kind of like, you know, on the schoolyard when you have your action figures, like, well, these G.I. Joes are mine. I play with Snake Eyes, Shockwave, and Flint, whereas this other dude's like, nah, Duke is the best, along with Storm Shadow and fucking, you
everybody
know.
Knows that Roadblock is the best G.I. Joe, John. Let's not have,
yeah, well,
have
I was
argument.
Gonna say there was a third person with Roadblock and Bazooka and Mutt, but, you know, and that's kind of the thing. It's like, well, it's these three characters are the best, so I'm gonna play with these three.
Yeah.
They said that there is no multiplayer.
Okay.
In the game, because they really wanted to focus on the single player experience.
Mm-hmm.
Now this is also early, so that could, they did say there's always a possibility that could change, but they don't think it is.
Now, when you were watching online, did they ever show any? Did they ever show any like dialogue? Because one of the things that I love most about Saints Row, I mean, I love Saints Row.
Yeah, no, there is dialogue. I mean, they even talk to each other as you're switching out between the characters.
Okay,
like,
cool.
It's kind of, it's like the switch out is almost like a tag-in animation kind of thing. And they will, like, one person will say something, it'll switch to the other character, and then another the character you switch to will respond.
Okay.
Sometimes it's them calling out dialogue to the people they're destroying or whatever, like, you know, ahoy motherfucker,
right,
you know, like that sort of thing. and the other thing they kind of described is when asking, like, how does this compare to Saints Row,
right?
They're like, well, if you think about it, Saints Row is a humor game with action elements,
right?
This is an action game with humor elements.
Okay.
So that their focus is on the action more, but this is, you know, it's Volition. They're like, no, we like our wild, zany, crazy, fucking batshit, stupid stuff.
Yeah, it looks really cool. I wonder, it's probably a given, right, that you're going to end up upgrading these characters.
Correct.
They're going to have, like, you know, they're going to get points for using them, and that you're then going to make them better and better and better.
Yeah, and then they showed off a fourth character that was not in the trailer, which is a girl with a bow and arrow.
Yeah. I'm actually kind of curious, because this is very, very combat focused, as opposed to, you know, in Saints Row, it's like you would almost just kind of run around, and then every so often you would get into combat, yeah, if there was combat, whereas this is like what we're seeing is like a third-person action game, you know?
Yeah, and I also like the fact that they were talking about, like, oh, and also, like, that you don't see it too much in these videos, but there is an element where there are going to be areas where there are going to be pedestrians and innocents,
mm-hmm,
bystanders. You don't have to protect them.
Yeah.
Because the reason the agents of Mayhem are there are not to protect civilians. They're just there to stop the Legion.
Nice.
So if you end up, you know, like using a civilian as a shield, well, that you know, you can't.
Tell
you
me
make
I
an
can,
omelet without breaking a few eggs.
Tell me I can run up and still pile drive a person. That's,
oh,
really,
I don't know.
Well, that's cool. I'm really looking forward to this. Volition, well, not Volition, Deep Silver, right? Are they the publisher?
Deep Silver is the publisher. Volition is the
developer, right?
Yeah.
They ain't done me wrong yet. So, you know, this definitely looks like it's different than Saints Row.
Yeah.
It does not look like Saints
Row 5.
This
doesn't take place in the same universe. It's you won't see Johnny Gat running around in this world, or at least if you do, it's going to be a tongue-in-cheek reference.
Well, the only thing I can hope for is that, you know, this particular set of gameplay footage that we're looking at has had an awful lot of shooting and very little story, and I really hope that the story holds up, because, you know, there's just plenty of stuff in Saints Row that's just absolutely fantastic.
Yeah,
I mean, you know, that whole beginning part where you're the president in Saints Row 4,
of course.
So awesome. So I really hope that they have some of that in there. All right, well, next up, John actually has more information for us, which is good. It gives me a little time to rest my tired jaws.
Yeah, rest your jaws from talking through that Nintendo thing where I was kind of like I don't care about 3DS games. I want to go to sleep. I'm tired.
About Injustice 2.
Yeah. So they announced Injustice 2, or it got leaked, and they just said, yeah, sure, it exists.
Yeah.
Releasing that weird, like, cinematic trailer last week. IGN and a few other people actually interviewed them at E3. They showed off some gameplay where you got to see, Atrocitus, Supergirl.
Does he have a cat, buddy?
Yeah, it's Dexter.
Oh, is he one of the
Red Lanterns?
Is he one of the Lanterns? Okay,
yeah,
I don't really know that much about
them. Atrocitus is the leader of the Red Lanterns, and the cat is Dexter.
Okay.
He's fighting Supergirl, and then there's also like Batman and Aquaman and Gorilla Grodd and Superman.
I love the fact that Gorilla Grodd is in this game. I'm not gonna lie, I think that's freaking awesome.
Yeah. So. They kind of, you know, they show the fighting, the combat. First of all, the game looks great. The big thing that a lot of people were curious about is that the big tagline for the game was "Every fight defines you."
Uh-huh.
And what that essentially means, and what they've revealed about it, is that every time you fight, every time you win a match, your opponent drops randomized loot.
Okay.
And essentially, the randomized loot is costume pieces.
Okay.
And some of them are just cosmetic and don't actually serve any purpose. Some of them will actually give you buffs to certain attacks. Some of them will actually unlock actual moves that you can't use unless you have them equipped.
Interesting.
So basically, as you get all these different items, you can basically mix and match and basically design how your character looks,
mm-hmm.
while at the same time also getting like certain buffs, certain move sets, certain other things. And the idea is that as you play the game, your character will be unique.
Okay.
It'll be your character, essentially.
So that's what they were trying to get across with the whole
shape changing armor,
the
suits.
Kind of thing. Okay. Oh, I love this. I love this little the environment texture where Black Manta knocked Supergirl back inside. That was pretty cool.
Yeah. So, you know, they do have the environment transitions that like they had in the previous game. They kind of like shortened them. Like they're not as long. Same with those special moves where they do like the big special moves. They kind of toned them down as well, because the big complaint that in tournament play was just that they were just so fucking long.
Right.
That like people didn't want to do them, because then they'd have to sit through these long freaking, cinematic pieces where nothing is happening.
Right.
So they kind of shortened them a little bit.
Okay.
And
did they confirm at all whether all of the characters from Injustice are coming back?
This is in the Injustice world.
Okay.
So essentially, and one of the things I actually thought that was interesting about the story here is that in this world, there are people who feel that Superman should not have ever been taken out of power, and that they want Superman back in power. And then there are those that are like, no, Superman, fuck Superman. He's an evil motherfucking dictator.
Yeah.
You know, kind of thing. It's this world kind of dealing with that. So I don't think there's going to be any like superheroes from the regular DC universe or whatever. I think this is purely going to be
in the Injustice world.
In the Injustice world by themselves, and the story for it is just going to be that.
Does that make the Red Lanterns good?
Well, the Red Lanterns are neither good nor bad. They're just really angry.
Okay. They're like Kratos. Kratos is
he would be a Red Lantern.
He's a Red
Kratos
Lantern.
Would totally be a Red Lantern.
Okay. Well, and looking at this, I mean, you know, I like what I'm seeing as far as, you know, the environments. I think characters are a little bit smaller than they were last time we looked at it. But yeah, I mean, you know, again, NetherRealm has done a real good job so far. So I'm glad to see them. Ooh, it's Aquaman versus Batman.
Yeah, but I really like the idea, the mechanic about, you know, the where you drop loot.
And is that do you know if that did they say if that's going to cut into multiplayer as well as single player?
There will be a multiplayer mode where you play it online multiplayer with the character that you've built.
Okay.
And that like anytime you win a match, whether it's just in regular play, you know, the free play, online multiplayer, or in the game mode, your opponent will drop loot, randomized loot.
Okay.
Someone asked if they're going to do like microtransactions because of that, and they were like, no, we don't. We can't say like for certain because we're still working all that out, but we don't want to do that.
I'm sorry, we're watching this, and Aquaman just hit Batman through the side of a bar, and then Batman was trying to get up, and he just got fucking hit. He just got hit. He just got hit by a car.
Yeah,
he got like slammed into by a fucking moving van or some shit like that.
Yeah. But yeah. So I mean, it really seems interesting. I am totally on board. I Injustice. While I have issues with the story because I really hate the idea
Superman
being corrupted. I thought the gameplay was solid.
Yeah.
I thought it was a really good game. I thought a fighting game, and I really enjoyed it. And the fact that if you actually looked at the character select screen when they had it up, there was a shit ton.
Yeah.
That was a huge roster. I think that was like almost like triple the size of Injustice.
Of regular Injustice.
So, I mean, there's a ton of characters that can be in this.
That's cool.
They're doing polls asking like, what characters do you want to see in this game?
Right.
Here's five characters. The one that gets the most votes will be in this game.
Oh, shit. So it looks like they have the same clash mechanic that they had last time.
Correct. And, you know, you can grab elements of the environment to attack, you know, people, just like in Mortal Kombat as well.
Okay. Here's what I oh, Batman missed his
ultimate. No, he didn't.
Oh, he didn't. Oh, the Batwing flew up. And then just what? Drops him? It's on autopilot? Oh, it's shooting him. It's shooting Aquaman. It shot a missile at him. All right, that was good.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, like I said, I'm really kind of excited for this. I want to see more. I want to play it. I hope the mechanic of getting loot and like customizing your character I hope that's as good as they're making it sound.
I want to make a really dumb looking Batman. So, you know, I want to make
Batman of Inzerah.
Inzerah, yeah. I want to make an Inzerah Batman, then take him online and be a crazy, crazy orange, yellow and purple Batman.
Or it may not be Inzerah. I may be saying that wrong. I think it's like Inzarur or something. I can't remember.
Okay, so there's some of the stuff we've got. 4.7% damage increase, and then it's just some like cosmetic, and Aquaman increased Trident damage. Okay, that's kind of cool. I like that. All right, well, I tell you what, let's roll through the rest of these. This actually came out like right after we recorded the podcast last week. The Call of Cthulhu Focus Interactive game that looks like. They should be more Call of Cthulhu games.
Yeah, the only one that I know of recently was the shitty early access one that was kind of garbage. It was like In the Mountains of Madness or whatever.
I think the only one that anybody ever remembers is the old one, the shooter one that was flawed but still kind of interesting.
Well, there was the one that was on the Xbox.
I think it might be the same one.
Oh, I can't remember if it was called Call of Cthulhu or whatever it was. I can't remember what it was called.
But this is a cool trailer. The dude is like looks like he's in Arkham or Innsmouth or something, like, you know, trying to figure out what's going on. There's no real gameplay in here. It's mostly just kind of environmental spookiness. But, you know, the fact that so far, John, Bloodborne is the best Cthulhu game that we've seen in the last decade is kind of crazy.
Yeah, there was a game on the Xbox called Call of Cthulhu, Dark Corners of the Earth that was really hard to find.
What is that piece of paper? John just pulled out his wallet, pulled out a piece of paper, examined that piece, unfolded like a 12-fold piece of paper.
It's a list of old console games that I have so that if I ever go to like Game Over Video Games or a retro video game store, I know what games I'm looking for.
Okay.
So that if I find them, I'm like, oh yeah, no, it's to remind me what games I want to buy.
Okay.
Like you'll notice there's a bunch of games that are scratched off because I've already bought them.
Okay. You just have to understand how strange that looked from my perspective. And he's like, what game was that? And then you pull out your wallet, you pull out this cryptic piece of paper, you look at it, and you're like, oh, it's Call of Cthulhu. That was the one.
It was called Call of Cthulhu.
That, no, I mean, like, the problem, I've been wanting to have that game on the show for a long time. I own it on the PC, but whenever I try to play it, it crashes at the end of, like, the first level. Like, the very first Asylum that we ever did, yeah. Grant and Jason and I tried playing that game four times. Jesus. And eventually just had to be like, nope, something else.
Yeah,
it's got to be
like, I know
else.
It's, like, one of the, like, rarest Xbox, original OG Xbox
games. OG Xbox games.
Yeah, it's, like, one of the rarest ones to find. So it's, like, if you can find it, like, it's one of those things where it's, like, a big deal.
You know, and between games like Insomnia and the Resident Evil 7 and, you know, PT and stuff, like, you could make a really good environmental kind of atmospheric Cthulhu game.
Yeah,
where
I'm totally on board for Call of Cthulhu, the official video game.
Yeah. I'd like to see one where if you ever look at something that's supposed to be... Actually, you know, when you go back and you look at all of the Cthulhu and Lovecraft mythos, like, all the different shit, like, what's the one where the eyeball comes out of the guy's head that they made the movie out of? Where that what's-her-face is like a dominatrix and they move into that. From Beyond!
Okay. Yeah, I was like, I have no idea what you're talking about.
I want to see somebody try to do Color Out of Space but make it a video game. How are you going to render that color on my screen? But yeah, this looks good. I'm interested, you know, I'm interested in seeing more of this. I kind of wish that they would have shown a little bit more of it in this particular trailer. Next up, this is more of like kind of a like, hey, just FYI. But apparently they're bringing out Hawken on the PS4.
Yeah.
It looks like kind of like just general OG Hawken. If you haven't ever played Hawken, it's basically robot on robot kind of multiplayer action. John and I played it a long time ago for the Super Awesome Video Game Show.
It was fun. It was actually, we played it like right before Titanfall came, or right when the beta for Titanfall came out.
Oh yeah, something like that.
Because we couldn't get access to the Titanfall beta at the time. We were like, fuck it, we want to play mech game.
Yeah, Hawken. So it actually ended up being one of the more popular Super Awesome Video Game Shows.
Yeah,
we
actually
ever did.
Really had a lot of fun playing that.
Yeah, I really enjoyed it. Apparently it's coming out as free to play on the PS4. Looks like they're going to be doing like cosmetic microtransaction stuff. But you know what? Hawken is fun. It's kind of like, you know what Hawken it reminds me of is like Warframe, right?
Yeah.
It's like one of those things where if you're just looking for a fun free-to-play game, bada bing, bada boom, go get yourself some Hawken. Next up, this isn't technically a new game, but they put out a trailer, and I just have to give props to the Bespin Star Wars Battlefront DLC trailer.
Yeah.
I think this looks really fun. I just fucking Lando's out there. It looks like they're doing Mech Assault on Cloud City. Like, that's insane.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it looks great. Like, I am all, like, it kind of makes me want to play the game some more.
Yep. We got Lando. We got, who's that guy? It's not Bossk. It's, who's Dengar.
Dengar.
With the diaper on his head.
Yeah.
There's some, you get to fly Cloud City cars in some of the aerial combat. There's going to be some new weapons. There's going to be some... There's one new game mode, and I don't know what it is, but in this particular trailer, it shows, like, a bunch of heroes and a bunch of stormtroopers, like, running for like, a dropship, like one of those rebel dropships, which is cool, and I want to play it. And then at the very end, we see a stormtrooper get pulled down into the carbonite freezing chamber.
Oh, I only hope that it pops back up and it's like in carbonite.
Here's the thing. I think that this looks way better than Outer Rim just because I like the way Bespin looks. It's one of the cooler Star Wars environments in my mind. A city in the goddamn clouds. So I'm looking forward to it. I know that this wasn't exactly... I know this isn't exactly new news. We knew that this was coming, but you know, whatever. Next up, Yakuza 0.
Gameplay trailer.
Yep, the 80s Yakuza. Again, this also looks just fun as hell.
Yeah, no, I totally want to play this.
Yakuza in the 80s. It's everything looks really pretty. I mean, you know, you and I and Amanda played the Yakuza
4, right?
It was 4. It had to be 4 that came out at Christmas time. This looks a little bit better, a little bit snappier. I always like the way that Yakuza games look, and I love the fact that money pops out of everybody.
Yeah.
Like fucking River City Ransom style, just coins and dollars come flying out of everybody that you hit. Oh, man, he hit that guy with a bicycle. I love the dumb white suit that one of the characters has.
Yeah, the Miami Vice white suit.
Yeah, yeah, he needs to push up his sleeves a little bit.
Where he shoves the end of the bat into the guy's mouth. It's
Looks like normal Yakuza. We've got disco dance parties, darts, billiards, all kinds of crazy stuff. Some kind of convoluted ass plot. I almost feel like this, if the goddamn Yakuza games weren't so goddamn long, I would want to play one of them for Sequential Saturday.
Yeah.
But if we did that, it would take a year.
Yeah.
It would, or like 8 or 9 months in order to finish one of these games.
Yeah, probably.
So much. So yeah. Yakuza Zero. You're okay in my book.
Yeah, no, I'm excited.
You're okay in my book. Next up, we've got a trailer for a thing that we've seen before. But this is a new trailer. I think, I'm pretty sure. It's labeled as an E3. I got off Sony's thing. So we heard about Robinson, The Journey. What is this called? Robinson, The Journey something? Yeah, Robinson, The Journey. Okay. Last year, we saw there was like a little, you know, little mech bot, little iBot from Portal rolling around. And you're out in a jungle and there's like some raptors and shit out there. That's what we saw previously. This one is more like kind of story driven where your character kind of wakes up and looks out the window and sees, It starts with this little mech. You're in like an escape pod. And this mech is adorable, John.
Yeah.
I really like this little guy. He's like Eva and Wally had a weird portal baby.
Yeah, it's weird.
So apparently this is the sort of thing where like you flash back and you see that you're leaving a space station that's just crumbling and blowing up in orbit, and the little iBot tells you that, you know, you're the first person on this planet and that I've done the math that you should probably just stay in your seat and wait for somebody to rescue you. And I love it because your character's like,
Nah, fuck that. I'm going outside.
Yeah, no, I'm not doing that. I hear dinosaur noises, and I'm going to go kill some fucking dinosaurs. So he gets up. He walks out. We don't really know that much about this outside of the fact that it's running on CryEngine. It's going to be on PlayStation VR, probably on the rest of everything as well. Looks real pretty.
Yeah.
And could definitely be. I'm always on the lookout for those full VR games. So if this is a full VR game, I'm totally down. I also like it. It's called Robinson the Journey, and the little robot keeps calling you Robin.
Yeah.
The entire time. Let's see. Next up, Attack on Titan. Wings of Freedom has an E3 2016 trailer. I feel like I'm just watching the show Attack on Titan.
Yeah,
at this point.
I do. Like, it does look like it's just recreating elements from the show, which is not a bad thing.
No.
You actually get to play sections of the show, which is, you know, could be fun.
Yeah. I think that we already knew that Aaron was in there, and we saw that he was a big Titan. And spoiler alert for Attack on Titan, if you haven't seen it, you don't even know what the fuck I'm talking about. So it's real pretty.
Yeah, no, it's very pretty.
Like, it's a very striking trailer, and I like the way everything looks with this kind of like half cell shaded anime style. Like, it looks real nice. I'm a little confused that they didn't show any actual any of the gameplay, but I guess they've been putting out trailers for this every so often for quite a while. Looks good. I do, though, wonder. I mean, I don't think it's exactly a secret. Everybody knows that Attack on Titan ends on a kind of a cliffhanger.
Yes.
It doesn't really resolve at the end of the first season. So I'm curious to know whether or not the game is going to just end on a story cliffhanger if it's following the show as closely as it seems to be from these trailers that we're looking at, because I don't know if that would be received super, super well.
Yeah.
I'll play it. We'll see what happens. Another thing that I realized that I watched some gameplay footage for that we didn't actually watch any videos for was Dragon Quest Builders. I watched about 20 minutes worth of gameplay for Dragon Quest Builders, which, if you remember, is the crazy Dragon Quest Minecraft game.
Okay.
Have you seen any of the trailers for this?
Vaguely. I think I saw like one thing that looked really boring.
We might have talked about it for 5 seconds on one of the shows. It's really strange because it's just a goddamn Minecraft ripoff. It's not a total goddamn Minecraft ripoff. It's Minecraft Square. It's a world built out of Minecraft squares with Dragon Quest monsters and Dragon Quest heroes and Dragon Quest yada yada. Now, when I was watching this demo, it's like you're going to be starting out like in a town, and then your job is going to be to kind of rebuild this town. You're going to get quests to go out and get materials, rebuild this town a little bit at a time. And they have things like blueprints for buildings where you put them down and then you have to fill in the materials that they're looking for. And then there's a I don't know if they're showing it here, but there's a meter at the top of the screen where you like level up your town. Okay. You can also craft different things. It looks pretty cool. The demo that I was showing at the end had one of those giant stone, like brick golems show up. The guy had a really pretty house, and then this giant brick golem showed up, and he went outside, and it just like threw a fireball that just went through the house and just destroyed.
You just said, "Fuck your house."
Yeah, yeah, like a creeper, except a giant golem.
He was all like, "You have a nice house there. Be ashamed of someone." Correct it.
That's right. I wonder if there was a way to restore that if you had the right amount of materials when you were done, because there was like the guy had made like all these bedrooms and like kitchens and big bay windows to look out into the world.
And then everything was destroyed.
So yeah, it seems like there's like a weird kind of like rampart mechanic going on here, where when you close up a thing and then you can make it into a room, you level up your city.
Yeah,
I get the feeling that you're going to be running around. Like in this demo that they were doing, they seem to be sticking to very much this one area. But I you know, it's Dragon Quest. There's going to be slimes and drakes and dragons and shit.
Yeah, it wouldn't be Dragon Quest if there wasn't.
Yeah, so I don't know. I'm still looking to see whether this is a full goddamn $60, because I don't know if I want to play a full goddamn $60 for what essentially amounts to a Minecraft game.
Okay.
When I already own Minecraft for fucking 10 bucks wherever you... How much is Minecraft these days?
I don't know.
Like, you just give it for free. Just get it for free wherever you go.
It's like, I don't know.
Okay. It's been a while since I've...
since like I've 10 or 20 bucks.
Purchased Minecraft, so... But, you know, it is real crisp. Like, it's a real crisp-looking game, and it's got kind of a nice little Dragon Quest style to it. So, yeah, you know. All right, next up on our miscellaneous trailers is Nier Automata. This was announced last year. Square Enix and Platinum Games making a new Nier game.
Yeah.
John, have you played any of the Nier games?
Nope.
Do you know anything about Nier?
Nope.
Is that the one that's got like the crazy ass endings where there's like 8 endings and some of them are just fucking...
All I remember about Nier is that there was a... It was the story. You were a father trying to find a cure for a disease with your daughter.
Mm-hmm.
And that was all. That's all I remember.
I'm thinking of something different.
I think you are thinking. Because you said games and there's only been one Nier game. This is the second one.
What is the world where... Kyle, we did a dojo for a Square game with a lady, and she's got a dragon that's got a speech impediment, and she's got like a flower grown out of her eyeball.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Am I having a seizure? This actually happened, right?
No, I think you're right. Like, I vaguely remember a flower growing out of eyeball thing, but I wasn't there to play that, so I don't know.
Okay. So there's only been the one Nier game. It was a PlayStation 2 game?
Yeah.
PlayStation 3 and Xbox 360. Okay. Let's see. No, I think this is the one that's got all the craziness at the end of it.
Yeah, it might.
If the player plays the game again, they start just after. They learn about the past, Gestalt, Nier, and Yona. Okay, I don't know. Anyway, this game is being made by Platinum. They talked about it last year. This particular trailer is not super long. It's just a minute long. And you've got these two protagonists. It looks like a boy and a girl that both have like black clothing and blindfolds on, and they're in some kind of weird area that's full of robots. There's a voiceover, or not a voiceover, but there's kind of like words over the screen saying, like, this is a world full of robots that are fighting forever with futility. This looks interesting. It definitely looks different than any Platinum game I've ever seen.
Yeah.
It looks kind of like rolling around in the open world. I can't tell if you're going to be rolling, if you're going to switch between the girl and the boy, because they both seem to be on screen most of the time. But it definitely seems like there's some, you know, like third person melee. There's actually one section that almost looks like a bullet hell shooter, where there's a boss that's just burping up these projectiles coming out in a weird bullet hell pattern. I don't know. This looks crazy.
Yes.
I'm interested in crazy. Whenever you can show me enough berserk-ass crazy to get me interested, I'm good to go. And yeah. It should be coming out earlier next year. So hopefully we'll get another trailer soon. I mean, you know, this didn't show really all that much. Got a lot of style, though. So got to give it points for that. Next up is a PlayStation game that I feel like... Oh, nope. I'm getting ahead. I've got two different lists here. Next up is the new Neo trailer.
Neo.
Which looks fucking crazy, and I love it.
He's it looks great.
Like a giant octopus, and like there's actually some like story stuff that seems to be going on here. Where do we even have a name for the main character?
I don't think we do yet.
Is he Neo? Is that what his name is?
I don't know.
They just didn't want to get all the Matrix jokes until the game came out. We do get to catch a couple of snippets of what look like different biomes.
Yes,
like kind of a. Stuff where there's a little bit more light. We catch a few crazy looking enemies. There's like a, looks like a succubus with a fucking snake face. And then towards the end, we actually hear the main character talk.
Yes.
And there's a character that says like, "Oh, I can't believe that you followed me this far," or something like that. And it almost seems like from the voiceover where there's a lady talking about, or is it a lady? There's a voiceover
talking about. It's a lady. About how you, as long as she's alive, you can never die.
You can never die, which makes me wonder if the core conceit of the game, because we didn't really know in the demo. We just wash up on the beach and then go.
Yeah.
But it makes me wonder whether or not the whole rebirth aspect for this particular character is part of their motivation in the story. If they can't die and they want to die, that would be pretty cool. You know,
or maybe it's a thing where he makes a deal with a demon to get revenge for something, and she goes, "Okay, fine, I'll make it so that you can't die, so that you live long enough to see your revenge."
Yeah,
and like you have to essentially sell your soul or something, and you're hunting this dude who's like, "Well, I can't believe you followed me this far."
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know. Yeah, but they got another beta demo coming out in August.
Nice.
So that's good. So more chance for Jeff and I and everyone else to play it and fall in love with it.
Yeah.
And then the game, if I'm not mistaken, comes out in like November or something.
Yeah. Shit. Back to Nier. But yeah, it looks like the gameplay footage seems like it's very much like what we've seen from Nier. Kind of a weird Dark Souls-esque, but with a really different flavor to it.
Yeah.
I really loved Nier. If you guys haven't gone and watched the super awesome video game show we did for it, I thought it was fantastic.
You mean Neo?
Neo. Sorry, not Nier. Too many end games altogether. Too many end gauges for me to keep track of which is which, John.
Which is weird because you don't own any.
I own several end gauges.
And you hold them like tacos.
I do. You had to talk into the side of that stupid thing, right?
Yeah.
It was shaped like a cell phone. Why could they put the... Okay. I'm not gonna complain about the end gauge. First of all, it's too late. Second of all, they don't exist anymore. Next up, we have one from Sony called Here They Lie, which I actually stumbled on.
Santa Monica Studio.
Yeah, Sony Santa Monica and the Tangentlemen, which is a great fucking name.
That is a good name.
This is a psychological horror game where the player is like walking around. I'm not entirely sure. It's going to be VR compatible. There's some crazy shit going on in this particular trailer. A lot of like, there's a shark in the air. There's people with pig masks. There's like cockroaches coming out of the wall. There's a shadowy figure with horns. It looks really, 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 really strange. And I can honestly say that I am into that.
Yeah.
I really want to know what that's all about. It's coming in fall of 2016, and it looks real good. I really like the black and white aspect of it.
That looks really, really cool.
Yeah. Let's see. Next up, John, do you want to talk to the people about Friday the 13th?
Friday the 13th, the game.
Yeah.
This is, if I'm not mistaken, it was originally a Kickstarter for something that was not Friday the 13th, the game.
Okay.
And it was going to be basically just inspired by.
Mm-hmm.
And then the people who own the rights to Friday the 13th for video games came to them and said, "Hey, how would you like to just turn your game into an actual Friday the 13th game?" And they went, Yeah.
Okay.
So essentially, it's one versus. It's one of those. You know, you have one bad guy, and it's
asynchronous multiplayer.
Yeah, it's one versus four.
Yeah.
So there's four camp counselors, and then there's. And then there's Jason.
Yeah.
Jason has various abilities. If you're playing as Jason, you can kind of anytime a camper makes a loud noise or something like that, it kind of tells him where they are,
mm-hmm.
and he can actually. It looks like it's with a cooldown, but it looks like he can actually teleport on the map around the map. To move around faster, to kind of go with that movie thing where you think you see him at one point and then like you run the opposite direction and he's there.
Yeah.
You know, to kind of.
Oh, hell, even Mortal Kombat XL, that was one of. He's a teleporter. He had one where he walks into the mist, right?
Yeah. So they do say this is an early alpha footage. It does look like early alpha footage.
A little but rough. A little rough.
And it also, the kills kind of come a little bit easy.
Yeah.
But like he runs into one girl and he like grabs her and like throws her on the ground or throws her head into a rock and then curb stomps her.
Yep. It's incredibly brutal.
It's incredibly brutal. And then there's like a scene where he just kind of stands in front of a window looking at the other two players, and the other two players freak out and run. And then like he goes, okay, well, I know where the exit is for that, so I'm going to come over here, which is right around the corner. And then the player ends up running right to where he teleported to.
Yeah.
And then he grabs her, throws her up against a wall, and like just starts slamming her head into the wall brutally.
It's kind of cool because Jason's walk speed is super, super slow.
It is.
But the fact that he can teleport from time to time, I love that idea. I also really like the fact that when this starts, it's like Jason's mom.
Yeah, she's telling him what to do.
Yeah, telling him to go kill them.
Yeah, and and then they do show a little bit of the camp counselor playthrough, play side.
Oh, I like that part quite a bit. Yeah,
where they show that you have a flashlight and you have a few other things. Having those things do give away your position to Jason by using them, so you don't want to use them too much.
Yeah.
There's also they show him actually like this one counselor get captured by Jason or grab, like Jason grabs him,
right.
And there is a break free mechanic where you can actually like. There's a moment where you can actually break free and get out of Jason's grasp.
Well, that's really interesting because, if the break free remains as easy as it seemed like it was to do in this trailer, like we've seen that, I don't know, but it seemed like Jason was only able to kill somebody by walking up to a thing and putting them up, like on a surface. Like he can't just kill them right where they are, which is interesting because it almost means that like being in the open is safer than being in a building. It's safer like in a short-term way.
Yeah.
Like if Jason's going to catch you, you want him to catch you out in the open where he has to walk to a place to kill you as opposed to catching you inside of a room where he can just
walk up. I'm sure there's some strategic planning in regards to that. They also do show that there's this thing where the camp counselor guy runs into the house, he locks the door to kind of slow Jason down a little bit.
Yeah.
And then he runs into the back room and turns on the radio and turns the volume up real loud, then opens up a window and hides. And the reason he does that is because when he turns on the radio, Jason can't hear him running or moving.
Right.
So Jason then can't see him because all he sees is the noise from the radio on his HUD.
The radio's playing hot 80s.
Yes,
hot 80s
is.
Hits.
Yeah, it is playing 80s hits.
What was the song that was playing?
Oh, I don't remember. Remember the song. But the guy then hides under the bed and Jason breaks into the room and,
I love that when the counselor is hiding and he's looking out when Jason shows up, it goes... like it does the Jason noise as a that was pretty cool.
Yeah, so it looks really cool. I'm hoping it's good. Like I like what I'm seeing so far.
Yeah. It's a little rough around the edges.
It is, and they do state this is an early alpha.
Yeah.
This is not even like anywhere near finished.
Yeah.
And it shows, but it shows in a way that it like has a lot of potential to be a lot of fun.
I need this game to be a success so that when they put out their first DLC pack, it adds Freddy in on the other side, and you both have to try to get to the campers first so we can have a full-on Freddy versus Jason beat down.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Anyway, I don't know. It does look real good. It looks solid. Looks like it's trying to... Like, I was asking Jason when we were playing another game that was kind of like this, like, has there ever been a truly successful asynchronous multiplayer game? Or was it you that I asked that?
I don't know. You might have asked me. The closest thing, and it wasn't really successful, is Evolve.
Yeah, I was trying to think of outside of Evolve if there's ever been another one.
And that wasn't really successful because no one's fucking playing Evolve anymore.
Right, right. Where, like, one person is... Yeah, I don't know. All right, well, that is enough Friday the 13th. A brief note, there was a trailer for The Walking Dead Season 3.
Yes, there was.
I don't know that you or I have a lot to say about this. Looks like the same old Walking Dead.
It does.
Zombies, Clementine.
I never finished the first season, so I never played Season 2 or, you know.
I started Season 2 with Grant and then never played it ever again. Just like every other Telltale game. Just like Tales from the Borderlands, just like Game of Thrones.
Yeah. Like I usually play like the first couple episodes and then I never touch it again after that.
Yep. All right. This is another one that came up right before E3 that we missed on our last podcast. Conan Exiles. Would somebody please take the rights for Conan away from Funcom?
Yeah.
John, please. They made that Conan MMO that fucked up. Like, have you ever read the Conan books?
I've read some of them, yes.
They're great. It's a great, like, brutal kind of world.
Yeah.
I'd love for somebody that was, like, competent. I mean, not that Funcom is the worst developer, but, like, this looks okay. It's, like, it's kind of just walking around in first person, fighting a bunch of stuff. And then it's got this whole, like, Minecraft element to it where you're going to build a civil... You're going to build... an empire or whatever and fend off hordes of monsters. Just doesn't seem like the right way to go.
Yeah.
Conan is a property about Conan the goddamn barbarian going on adventures. You could make a third person action game with some decent mechanics, God of War style, and you should be able to just do a few things differently, and you should be able to make something that's...
They kind of did that already. There was a Conan game like that.
Was there?
Yeah.
Was it any good?
No.
Okay. Well, then make a good one. That's my advice to you developers, is make it like that one that John's talking about, but good. Because this, it just isn't doing a whole hell of a lot for me. I mean, the imagery is kind of cool, but the gameplay looks real stilted, and the whole thing just looks a little stiff to me.
Yeah.
So
it kind of comes like an online MMO.
Yeah, it does. Or like an offline MMO?
Like an offline MMO. It's just, I mean, the look of it, the graphic fidelity of it kind of comes off like an MMO.
Yeah, because...
Not to say those are bad graphics that for in MMOs, because there are some MMOs that look great. It's just, it looks like what I've come to expect from MMOs.
Yeah, it's kind of low res.
Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah, it doesn't look
something that's designed to run on as many PCs as possible.
Right. Yeah. Where they're not really looking for, or like just using... they can't afford to get the new Unreal Engine, so they're still using the last Unreal Engine type of thing. All right, we got two more, and then we're out. First up, The Technomancer.
This game comes out at the end of the month.
Yeah, hell yeah. And this is Spiders, which I believe are the guys that made Breath of Fire.
I don't know if they made that, but I know they made Mars Warlogs, which this might be in the, this game might actually be in the same universe as that game because it has like a lot of the same themes.
Okay, let's see. Spiders, the company, made Technomancer, Bound by Flame. Yep, Mars Warlogs of Orcs and Men, which I believe was the prequel to the Styx series.
Yeah,
Testament of Sherlock Holmes, a bunch of other stuff. This looks like the most polished game from these guys that I've ever seen.
Yeah, no, I agree with that.
As a cinematic trailer, we're getting a lot of like Mars and like I was created for battle, and then like a bunch of kind of like sassy lady characters who are all like, "I'll show you a good time, honey face." There's not an actual lot of gameplay, but I doubt it's changed much since that big fat 15-minute demo or whatever that we saw a few months ago. It looks like a really, really solid game.
Yeah, I can tell you, because I mean I talked to you about Mars Warlogs when it first came out. It's like that game had a lot of potential but kind of fell short.
Yeah.
I kind of hope that this is what they promised on that game, but they deliver this time.
Yeah.
I'm kind of hoping that's what this is with this one.
I'm kind of willing to give Focus. Focus is kind of like my own little subcategory of Devolver Digital, right? Like, I like to give their games a fair shake because Breath of Fire came out when there was nothing out, and I played it, and I was like, you know what? This is solid. It's not the best game I've ever played, but it works pretty well.
Yeah.
You know, they made Battlefleet Gothic Armada that we played for Indie Friday. So, yeah.
This game even takes place on Mars.
There you go.
So I think it is in the same world as Mars Warlocks.
It might be like the kind of like sticks to the of Orcs and Men.
Yeah.
But yeah, kind of interesting looking. Like, it's not super high resolution, but the characters all tend to have a lot of personality, it seems like.
Yeah.
So yeah, we'll see at the end of the month whether this bargain basement Adam Jensen fucking snake arms guy works out or not. And last, but certainly not least, for our E3 2016, John saw more of this than I did, but we finally saw more Let It Die.
Let It Die from Suda51 and Grasshopper Studios.
Oh, my Suda51, you are one of my favorites.
Yeah, this is a free-to-play game that's going to be available on the PS4.
Did they say when?
I don't think they said when.
Let me check and see.
It has a lot of Dark Souls elements to it.
He said it, folks.
They've said it.
Yeah.
They even said that there's a little bit of a Dark Soulsian elements to it. Like, one of the interviewers said it, and they were like, yeah, I guess you could say that. But it, like, takes place in the near future after the Tokyo Olympic Games. Like, this weird tower appears outside of off the coast of Tokyo, and...
And then what happens? Do they, like, send people there?
Go there and they try to climb the tower, and they have to kill things to climb the tower. And when you start off, you're completely naked.
Yeah.
So you have, like, no weapons, no clothing outside of your underwear. And then as you kill things, you pick up items and can equip them and get stronger as well. I also like the fact that, you know, when you kill a thing, it bursts into coins sometimes.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Like, I remember them talking with Suda about that, where he was like, of course
yeah.
It does.
So it has this kind of weird, interesting mechanic that instead of having a stamina bar,
yeah,
the way you determine how much stamina your character is that the more stamina you use, your heart starts glowing inside of your chest.
Mm-hmm.
So if you see your heart glowing, that means you're running out of stamina. They said that it's going to be free to play, and they were going way out of their way to make sure that you could play this game and be able to unlock everything without paying money, because they didn't want a pay-to-win scenario.
Right.
There are even some items that you can only get by playing the game, and you cannot get by paying money.
Oh, there you go. No, I like it. It's like there's some funky finishing moves. There's some weird-looking shit. I like the idea. Goddamn. This guy just with the handsaw just going through somebody's head.
Yeah.
I like what they also had. They talked about, I don't know if there's multiplayer, but they did say that, like, I swear to God that I heard them say that, like, when your friends die in their world, that their character will then be brought into your world as, like, an invader or an enemy.
Yeah,
that you can then,
I think so, yeah. I think you're right on that.
Is there any kind of, like, do you know if there's any permadeath, or if it's, like, when you die, do you start over, or do you just go back to a checkpoint?
I don't know.
Well, it's got to be checkpointed, because otherwise, like, if you had to pay money for stuff and then you went back to the beginning, people would be all upset.
Well, the paying money for is less for, I don't know. Like they kind of didn't really specify what you're paying money for,
mm-hmm.
but it's like not pay to win, but it's pay to lower the grind.
Yeah.
Or lessen the grind. So it seems like if you're not paying, you're just grinding more than you normally would.
Yeah. I don't know. This this one looks right up my alley. I'm always one to give Suda51 some leeway.
Yeah.
Some rope. Because no matter what you want to say about his games, they're always... fucking!
I mean, look at this fucking creature. It's like a giant monster, and it has like body parts just like
it's like
tied
mannequin
to it.
Legs like sticking out of it. Yeah.
Yeah, just tied to it.
Yeah,
as armor.
So yeah, this looks pretty cool. I kind of wish this had been a little bit more front and center. I found the one video on Sony's website for this because it looks kind of cool.
Yeah, and this is actually the same video I saw at E3 mm-hmm. streaming. So this is the exact same video that I watched.
Yeah. I love the blood and guts. I love the kind of insanity of it all. I will definitely be checking this game out, if nothing else than just for the crazy, crazy kills.
And it's free to play. So,
free,
you know,
yeah.
It's going to be free to play.
There's the name of the store in the background called Die or Die. I will choose Die. And you know what? That's it.
That's it.
We finished.
Oh, I can go home.
Oh, we finished. So let's just wrap it up real fast. John, what did you think about E3 this year?
I'm going to be honest. I felt like E3 was a little bit of a letdown this year.
Yeah.
And not so much in that there wasn't stuff to be excited for, because there are some things I am super excited for. Agents of Mayhem, Let It Die, Dead Rising 4.
Sure.
South Park, Fractured But Whole.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to think of like all the press conferences and all the things that I'm excited for, kind of thing. Yeah. You know, For Honor.
Good luck, because yeah. We've gone over a hell of a lot.
You know? For Honor, just a whole bunch of stuff.
Yeah.
There is like stuff that I'm like, oh my God, I'm so excited for these games. But I feel like there wasn't, like, usually like there are surprises.
Yeah.
I don't feel like I was surprised by anything this year. I felt like I knew about everything that was announced before E3 actually started. Like, you know, they released the trailer for Agents of Mayhem before E3.
Sure.
Which, so I knew about Agents of Mayhem.
Well, let's just take, for example, because we recorded this one today, it's fresh in our minds, Ubisoft, right?
Yeah.
Everything that was at Ubisoft except for Steep we knew about, and I'm like, okay, Steep.
Yeah. Well, it's like look at Microsoft. Everything, you know, the Scorpio, Project Scorpio was rumored already.
Yeah.
The Xbox, you know, One S was already kind of rumored for months now.
Right.
The only game that was not previously announced at a previous event that they showed, that they actually talked about, was Dead Rising 4, and that leaked the Monday before E3.
Right, right.
So it was just kind of like one of those things where it's like, well, okay.
Not a lot. That's one of the best things about E3 is going like, oh, holy shit, I didn't even know you guys were making another one of those. And then it's like, oh, yeah, they totally are. And
I mean, the things I get excited for are the things that I didn't know I was going to get.
Sure.
And even Sony's conference, like, while for yes, there were a lot of things like I didn't know there were. I knew they were making a new God of War. I mean, it was foregone conclusion they were going to make a new God of War game at some
eventually,
and there were rumors that it was going to be Norse mythology around.
We've talked about that before.
So while it was like, oh shit, this is the new God of War, that was surprising, but the idea of there being a God of War, another God of War game, was not.
Well, Resident Evil 7, I remember reading some articles from like people like Pachter who were like, when you look at the trends, it's time for Capcom to make a new Resident Evil game. We should be seeing it sometime this year, you know?
Yeah.
I remember reading stuff like that. I think that the only stuff that really was huge, I mean, I'm trying to think of something else so I don't just sound like a fanboy, but like Death Stranding was interesting. Quake was interesting.
Yeah.
I didn't know that Quake was happening.
Hell, even though I knew it was coming out, being shown as much as we were of Zelda was fucking interesting.
Yeah. Well, because we hadn't seen Zelda before, and that much gameplay is kind of a big thing. I'm trying to think back to EA and think if anything they did was...
They did not do anything surprising at all.
What was the
outside
first thing?
Of having celebrities that were baked.
What was the first thing that they showed at EA? I don't even remember. It's so late. There's so much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just feel like there weren't a lot of surprises, and because of that... I mean, I think, you know, there were some surprises as far as like the VR stuff, like the Star Trek Bridge Commander, I think was interesting. Sea of Thieves was way better than I expected. The presentation for Sea of Thieves was way better than I expected it to be.
Sure.
So there are things that I'm excited for, but I feel like if you compared this to, in some ways it's better than previous years, but in other ways it's worse.
Well, I honestly feel like we're in a lull. When you look at last year and some of the stuff, I mean, you know, we're between there's a lot of franchises that we've seen new iterations for where those teams are now, like, we just got Uncharted 4 this year, right?
Yeah.
Hopefully next year Naughty Dog will have something interesting and new to show us, right? You know, I'm surprised that Kojima even had a trailer at this one.
Yeah.
Next year will probably be something from Software, you know. Capcom will have a little bit more of Resident Evil. Well, wait, when is Resident Evil 7 supposed to come out?
It's supposed to come out in January.
Okay, so not that. Yeah, I don't know. It's nothing from Rockstar. You remember all the rumors about Red Dead 2?
Well, and that goes back to the thing that we even said before, is that Rockstar they don't do E3.
Yeah.
And, you know, they have come out and made announcements at other people's stages. So we said, if Rockstar makes announcements, they'll do it during the Microsoft panel or the Microsoft press conference or the Sony press conference. It'll happen at one of those two if they make an announcement. They'll probably make an announcement about the new Red Dead sometime within the next few months.
Yeah. As I go back and mull it over in my mind, it's really, really disappointing that EA didn't have more of either Andromeda or one of those Star Wars games, either the Remedy one or the Visceral one,
yeah,
to show off. Oh, Titanfall 2, we hadn't seen... Have we seen anything from Titanfall 2?
We knew it existed, but we didn't know anything else past that.
Which was okay. It wasn't the best thing I've ever seen in the world, but it wasn't chopped liver either. So yeah, I'm kind of with you where it felt like a weirdly muted E3. It almost felt like, if they'd have just kept their mouth shut with a lot of those early announcements that we saw, that if we'd gone through the press conferences, that we would then could have had those announcements trickled out over the next few days, as opposed to seeing them all before. It almost felt like day one of E3 for people that were there was the end of E3 for those of us here at home.
Yeah.
Because it was just a lot of showing the same thing that we've already seen.
Yeah, it really did. Like it felt, because I mean, previous years, yeah, you would get the what was announced at the press conferences, but then like day one, day two, day three would just be filled with like tons of games that you had never heard of, the indie games that were not necessarily the AAA games, but just all these other games that you wouldn't have seen otherwise. And this year it just kind of felt like everyone was like, no, let's just keep repeatedly showing the AAA games that all the press conferences announced.
No, because usually on the last day of E3, which is which would be yesterday as of us recording, right on Thursday, that's usually when I expect all of the coverage to go back to just cycling on a loop of stuff you've already seen. But up until that point, I felt like in the past we've seen a lot of like, all right, bring Watch Dogs 2 over here, and don't just show us the gameplay that you showed on stage. Play it here at this booth, right?
Yeah. We Happy Few is another one I'm excited for.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Definitely interested in that. No, I mean, there's a lot of stuff to be interested in. I guess there was just nothing to just blow your socks off with, right? Maybe, I don't know. You guys that are listening, maybe chime in down in the comments and let us know. Did your socks get blown? Did you blow some socks? Did you... Your socks, Zelda, did Zelda do everything and nothing for you? Did it do nothing to do everything?
Did the HD Skyrim Special Edition announcement get your goat?
I want to play Skyrim again. Now.
Yeah, you want to play Skyrim again?
I want to play Skyrim again.
All right.
All right, and that's it. And we're done.
We're done.
Fucking fuck.
I'm going home.
Yeah, you go home. I'm going to walk my dog, and we're not going to do this shit again. I don't want to see you until the day after tomorrow, I guess, is when we have to see each other to get the rest of this fucking shit out of the way. All right, you jerks, we're done. It's E3 2016. I hope you're happy. Both John and I have lost several years of our lives. I look like Dorian Gray. Thanks for listening. You guys are the best. And I wish it wasn't too late for me to go to the bar. What is that?
Dorian Gray? So you look like
I looked at the picture of him.
Oh.
The one that's all like old and weasened and stuff.
I was a little confused.
Yes. I look like the Crypt Keeper.
Oh,
now.
Okay.
Just bacon. And
so the dude who drank the wrong grail
Exactly.
The Holy Grail.
Exactly. Yeah.
Last Crusade.
All right. Bye.